In the previous video, I talked about the need for a voltage amplifier to have a large input impedance, a small output impedance, and a well-defined gain that one can control in the circuit. The particular microchip that you're seeing here is called the LM741 op amp, and it's a popular type of amplifier that I'll describe in this video. As you might notice, there's no dial on this microchip where you can say, okay, give it a gain of 2, give it a gain of 3, give it a gain of 100. This particular amplifier just has a very, very large built-in gain, and we're going to have to use other circuit elements connected up to this microchip in order to actually control the gain. Let me show you how it's done. This is the circuit symbol for an op amp, or operational amplifier, like the LM741. Unlike the amplifier that I showed in the previous video, where it had only a single line at the input and a single line at the output, this is a type of amplifier known as a differential amplifier. If we define the two input pins as V plus, V minus, and the output pin as V out, then the differential amplifier takes some number, A, and multiplies it times the difference of the two input pins in order to give us the output voltage. It's this A that's a very large number in the LM741 op amp. Let's talk about an ideal op amp. In an ideal op amp, the gain is infinite. You might be wondering, how can the gain possibly be infinite if the output voltage is finite? Well, this brings us back to an interesting property from mathematics. If you need a finite number and infinity is multiplied times something else, you're not going to get it except for one very special case, and that is when the other number happens to be zero. You might recall that infinity times zero is indeterminate. It's not undefined, it's indeterminate, which means that it could possibly be a non-infinite number. So if our ideal amplifier is going to give us a finite output voltage, then the two input pins need to equal one another. Now, practically speaking, the LM741 op amp, for instance, doesn't really have an infinite internal gain, but it has a very large gain, and that gain is not very well defined. It's not controlled very well, it's just a very large number. We're going to have to use other resistors in the circuit in order to stabilize that gain. We don't necessarily have to do that. For example, if we were to wire up an op amp like this, we would probably end up with a very large, yet uncontrolled output voltage. The gain would be positive. If I were to swap the input pins on the amplifier, then the output would also be a very large version of the input, but with the polarity flipped. This is not a common configuration of the LM741. Let's take a look at a possible way to actually wire the circuit up, and I'll show you how to program any gain you want. The circuit symbol that we typically use only has three pins, the two input pins and the one output pin. But the actual chip has a few more pins that you would need to make connections to. If you look at one of these chips, they typically have a notch up here at the top so that you can tell which side of the chip is the top and which side is the bottom. So you want to be careful not to get the chip on the wrong side or you'll end up wiring it up wrong. Pin 8 is not connected to anything. Pins 5 and 1 of the chip control the offset null. It's a way to adjust small errors in the op amp, and we're not going to be using those pins for the moment. The only five pins here that make a difference are the two input pins, the output pin, and the two power supply pins. Let me show you how to wire up these two power pins, since this is a common point of confusion. I'm going to assume that we're going to use two 9-volt batteries as our power supply. We'll first wire the two 9-volt batteries together in series. This point is called the ground. Anywhere else on the circuit where I draw that grounding symbol, I will want to hook it right to that point too. Because we've defined the ground as the midpoint of our series connected power supply, we're left with a positive 9 volts at the positive power pin with respect to that ground. Furthermore, we're left with negative 9 volts at the negative power supply pin with respect to ground. Let's now talk about the other three pins and how one can define the gain. Let's take a look at this non-inverting op amp configuration. I've not shown either of the two power line connections because we've just seen how to wire it up. The only thing that you might want to keep in mind is that the power line voltages need to be higher than any voltage that you would expect to come out of the output pin of that op amp. Since I showed 9-volt batteries in the last diagram, we would want to make sure, for example, that whatever voltage comes out of the output pin of this amplifier would not exceed plus or minus 9 volts. Otherwise, it would probably be clipped off. To be safe, we should probably keep it within plus or minus 7 volts. I've previously mentioned that for op amps, the ideal built-in gain is infinite. Of course, the real amplifier doesn't have an infinite gain. The idea here is to find out if we can get a well-controlled gain. Let's start by assuming that the gain is not plus or minus infinity. This assumption means that the voltages at the two input pins have to equal one another. Of course, if we later discover that those two voltages are not equal to one another, then our original assumption would be wrong. We saw that in this very simply wired circuit. The overall gain, which I'm now just calling gain, is the output voltage divided by the input voltage. I'm assuming an ideal op amp, so the internal gain is still infinity. That's how I arrived at this assumption that the two input pins have to equal one another. I'm interested in the overall gain of the circuit. Because I've assumed that the voltages at the two input pins are equal to one another, this voltage must also be Vin. Because I know that an ideal op amp, or even a very good op amp, would have a very high or even infinite input impedance, I know that the current going into that op amp should be very close to zero. Because there's no current flowing out of this branch, I know that the current through both of these two resistors should be the same. Let's call it I. We'll use Ohm's law, V over R, to find it. Combining these two equations, I can eliminate I. After a few basic algebraic manipulations of this equation, I can determine the ratio of V out to V in. I've now determined that the gain of this particular circuit is not infinite, but rather it's a finite number, 1 plus R1 over R2. I've not contradicted my original assumption, so it must have been true. Even if my amplifier is not ideal, that is, even if the built-in gain is not infinity, but rather some very large number, this gain is probably highly accurate. For the LM741 op amp, typical values of resistors to use would be on the order of a few kiloohms. You really wouldn't want to use small resistors in the ohm range or very large resistors in the mega ohm range for reasons that I'll discuss in a future video. Let's take a look at another op amp configuration. This is called the inverting configuration. Let's find the gain. Let's start off by assuming that the overall gain is a finite number. This assumption leads to V plus equals V minus. Since V plus is grounded, then it means that the voltage at V minus should also be 0 volts. If we label the input and output voltages as V in and V out, respectively, I can write the formula for the gain as V out divided by V in. If we assume that this amplifier is ideal or nearly ideal, then the current going into this pin should be 0 or nearly 0. In that situation, all of the current passing through resistor R2 has to flow around resistor R1 as well. These two currents are equal to one another. Just because both of these two input pins are at the same voltage doesn't mean that current can freely flow between them. Let's use Ohm's law to find this current I. In equals V in divided by R2. Applying it to this resistor, current is flowing from 0 to V out, so I equals minus V out over R1. These two currents are equal to one another, so it's not very difficult to conclude that the voltage gain of this inverting op amp configuration is minus R1 over R2. Obviously, it's called inverting because of the presence of this minus sign. What it means is if you send a signal into the amplifier that looks like this, you're going to end up with a signal at the output that's flipped over. It has a 180-degree phase change. In the next video, we'll go over to the bench and put together one of these amplifiers and see how well it performs.